I would move heaven, hell, and anything in between to get to you. You wouldn't be safe anyway if I was mad at you. And that's not bull, Dip. That's truth. I've went up against people. You could pull a gun on me, and if I'm mad at you, I'm coming forward. You'd have to shoot me to stop me. And if you don't kill me, you're stupid. Because the next time you see me, I will kill you.
Mr. Kuklinski, we're going to conduct a bat search here. Put your arms out.
On May 25, 1988, Richard Kuklinski was convicted of multiple murder and sentenced to life imprisonment. This ended 30 years of cold-blooded killing by a master criminal police called the Iceman.
Richard Kuklinski is one of the most dangerous criminals we have ever come across in this state. He murdered by guns. He murdered by strangulation. He murdered by putting poison on victims' food. He did all of this at the same time while exhibiting a normal, placid family existence.
How many people have you killed?
I have an approximate guess. Approximate will go with more than 100.
How do you feel about killing?
I don't. It doesn't bother me. It doesn't bother me at all. I don't have a feeling one way or the other. I think if I had a choice, I wouldn't.
Richard, when you were on the streets, what kind of weapons did you use?
When I was out on the street to do something, I carried 3 guns and a knife. I had a derringer in each pocket. And a gun on my ankle, a bigger gun just in case. And a knife. And it all depends how it came about.
You indicated yesterday that he used a shotgun to grab a stoplight or something like that?
I had a red light. We were following this fellow. I pulled up at a red light, came alongside of him, and shot the shotgun, took his head off. He never saw the green light. As a matter of fact, when it happened, it surprised me. I expected the man to die, but it really surprised me when it took his head off. It was something I didn't expect. Most people paid their bills. Some didn't. I remember one guy, he was owed a lot of money. Well, I guess a considerable amount of money. He thought he could hide behind a door. It was a nice door, expensive door. Anyway, most people don't realize that when you come to answer a door, if there's light in the background, the person on the outside can look through the peephole and see the guy coming to the door. So he came to the door, I asked who it was, and he looked through the peephole. And he never saw what hit him. I've been in a restaurant where we were eating, and the guy went to the bathroom. And while he was in the bathroom, we put a little boost in his food. And he was rushed to the hospital after that. And he died. And they buried him. I'm not exactly sure what they put on, what they attributed his death to. But, you know, it wasn't homicide.
Mo, what was it like to cut somebody up with a, you know, the other guy was dead? How did it feel to cut some guy up with a chainsaw?
Well, I didn't have any feeling one way or the other. That just happened. That's the way it had to be.
Messy.
Yes. Yes, it was.
Did it make you sick?
No. I've had requests where the guy wanted the guy's tongue cut out. And he also wanted his tongue put in his rear end. So I believe there was a definite point he wanted to get across. I have an experience that I don't know if I should tell you or not. That it probably would offend a lot of people. I don't know, I don't think I should, I'll go into that.
Go ahead.
Nah, it's not a good one.
No, go ahead, tell him.
There was a man, he was begging and pleading and praying, I guess. And he was pleased God and all over the place. So I told him he could have a half hour to pray to God. And if God could come down and change the circumstances, he'd have that time. But God never showed up. And he never changed the circumstances. And that was that. It wasn't too nice. That's one thing I shouldn't have done, that one. I shouldn't have done it that way. It was a Jekyll and Hyde existence. The way it was and the way I wanted it to be were absolutely two different lives. I wanted one life. I had to have another life.
This other life would interrupt one Christmas Eve. While his family was celebrating the holidays, Kuklinski left his home to collect on a bad debt. Business was business. Even on Christmas Eve.
The man owed me money. He was giving me a runaround. I told him I wasn't happy that he wasn't gonna pay me. He had the attitude that nobody could hurt him. I think he was wrong. Only way he never saw Christmas.
Who did you use?
A gun. Extremely loud inside of a car. Matter of fact, my ears were ringing for a long time.
What'd you do afterwards?
I walked away, got in my car, and went home.
What'd you do when you got home?
I put toys together for the kids for Christmas. I saw the broadcast while I was putting the toys together that came down. Mob-related killing. That was the first time I knew I was mob-related.
How'd you feel?
I was annoyed I couldn't get the damn wagon together. What is it to dispose of something? You throw it away. You throw it anywhere. It all depends. If you don't want it found or if you want it found. If you want it found, it doesn't matter. You just leave it there. If you don't want it found, you could take it somewhere. You could bury it. You could put it in a big drum. You put it in the trunk of a car and have it crushed. You leave it in town, you can put it on a park bench. I mean, you know, you can put it anywhere you want. They found a few people sitting on park benches, I'm sure. As a matter of fact, I know they have. I hated my father. If I could have, I probably would have killed him. Probably would have felt good about it, too. My father would beat me just if I looked at him. He gave me this impersonal feeling I have to when people die in front of me, especially loudmouth people. Loudmouth people remind me of my father. Once a loudmouth person starts with me, I love it. That's the only excuse I need.
One night in a bar, a loudmouth made the mistake of insulting the 18-year-old Kuklinski in front of people. A couple of hours later, the Iceman saw his chance to get even.
I come out of this bar and I see him sleeping in his car. I said, I got you, little sucker, now I got you. I'm gonna light your fire. And I did. I got myself a bottle, some gasoline, and I threw it in the car with him. And he was screaming and yelling and burning, and the car burned. And I could smell him. I walked down the block and I could hear him as I turned the corner. He was still yelling. This was a personal thing, yeah. See, this was a guy I disliked.
What did he do to you?
He made me mad.
How were you with animals at that age?
Deadly.
Cats, dogs?
Cats, dogs. I used to tie two cats' tails together. I drove them over a clothesline and watched them rip each other apart.
How long does it take?
Not long.
Did they both die?
I don't know. I never stood around to see the final thing. I would say eventually they both died because they were both pretty well tore up.
Gotta be noisy.
It was quite noisy.
What else would you do with cats?
Well, we had the incinerator in the projects there. So I threw a cat in the incinerator. Then I threw a book of matches in there. And through the door, I watched the fire get bigger and bigger, and this cat was running around, trying to get away. Eventually, the fire got too big for him, and he didn't run anymore.
You only did one cat?
No. That was a pastime.
Did they all behave the same way?
Mostly. One almost got out the door. He almost jumped back up, came out the door, I threw him in. Because that's where I was looking, and he almost came back out. Couldn't get to this person. He was in a disco. So I was really in a bad way because there was a time schedule involved. And I happened to be watching these people, and there was a couple of gay people dancing and whatever. And nobody was paying them no mind whatsoever. They were walking anywhere, going anywhere, because people basically don't look at gay people. But the idea came to me, yeah, try to act gay, but how in the hell am I going to get by? A 300-pound gay man, I mean, you know, that's a little bit far-fetched. So I went to the extreme of far-fetched. I got this loudest costume you'd ever want to see on. I mean, I went full-blown gay person. Of course, maybe not a gay people are going to be pissed off at me, but I'm not saying anything bad about them. But I got this canary yellow sweater and these bright pants and I got these elevated shoes, which I'm told to be good. Now I got these thin shoes on, and I acted like a full-blown gay person. I mean, and I got on this thing, and I'm doing this like dancing bit, and I get onto this thing, and they got these lights, and I hate those lights, by the way, those strobe lights. Man, I hate those lights. They can't see good with them lights, and it messes up my eyes. So anyway, I'm trying to get close to this guy. So I'm doing this crazy thing. I'm acting real swishy. I guess that's what you would call it. And I get up close to this guy. And I bump into him. But everybody's bumping into everybody. And he had a heart attack. Because I had hypothermia, you know. When I bumped into him, I popped him with the needle.
What was in the needle?
In his case, a heart attack. He wanted this guy taken care of. But he wanted to talk to him first. So when I got to the place, I asked the man for the money. So the guy says he didn't have it and Roy would just have to wait until he got the money to pay him. And that was that, he'd have to wait. So I said to the man, I said, well, you have to then talk to him. He wants to talk to you. So I dialed the phone number and he got on the phone, and I said, he wants to talk to you. So he was talking to him, and I guess they were acting like everything was all right, because he got off the phone, he handed me the phone back. He says, hey, I told you he'd wait. He's in the better frame of mind. Don't worry about it. He wants to talk to you now. So I picked up the phone, and he said, kill him. So I shot him. Hung up the phone and walked away. I am just a hardworking expediter of sorts. I looked at myself as a person who did something that somebody wanted done, and they paid me a good price.
The Iceman had killed by gun, by knife, by Molotov cocktail, and cyanide.
but he also liked to experiment.
Crossbows, I just popped a guy in the forehead with it. Actually, it was just seeing if it would work.
What was he doing at the time?
Looking at me.
Well, was he sitting down, or were you standing over him? Or?
No, he actually bent down to look in the car window like I was asking him directions. I didn't know the man.
Was this a contract murder, or was it something out of anger, or was it a personal thing?
Neither.
What was it?
I just wanted to see if this thing would work.
You mean you're experimenting on somebody?
Right.
Did it work?
It sure did. Went halfway into his head.
The New Jersey Organized Crime Task Force concentrated on closing in on Kuklinski. When Kuklinski began to feel cornered, he started eliminating anyone who could implicate him in his criminal activities. If he called you friend, you had a problem. Yesterday's friend soon became tomorrow's enemy. One of those friends turned enemy was a man who had been Kuklinski's partner. His name was George Maliband.
Georgie boy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Liked him. Actually, yeah, really liked him. One of the few people I ever really liked.
But Maliband had developed some bad habits. He racked up thousands of dollars in gambling debts to loan sharks. Kuklinski had vouched for him and told Maliband he'd better pay up. Then Maliband made a fatal mistake. He told Kuklinski that if he didn't back off, he would hurt his family.
Which really struck a nerve with me. It upset me, but I was trying not to get upset with it at that time. So I figured he was just nervous maybe, and he was just spouting off, but apparently he wasn't.
But the Iceman couldn't forget that Maliband had threatened his family, and several weeks later, he began to plan his murder.
We got in the van, and I said, George, you're really sincere with the fact that you had hurt my family and to get back at me? And he said, that's the only way I could get you. I could get over on you, or get you to do what I wanted you to do, is to hurt your family. I said, but that's a stupid thing to say, George. I said, knowing how badly or how sincere I am about my family, I said, for you to say something like that, you must realize you're gonna make me mad. He said, no, you won't be mad. He said, because you'd be afraid that something would happen to your family. I said, well, you're very wrong about that, George. I said, because I'm going to put a stop to that. As a matter of fact, I'm going to put a stop to that right now. And I shot him 5 times.
Kuklinski's favorite way of disposing of bodies was putting them in barrels. But with a 6-foot, 300-pound George Maliband, it wasn't easy.
So when I got him in, I had a problem with one leg. A hell of a problem with a leg, I'll tell you. No matter what I did, I couldn't get that leg in there. So I had to cut it.
You want to talk about your brother, or?
What do you want to talk about? There's nothing to talk about.
Because we never brought up your brother in the first show.
Well, you want to talk about him? We'll talk about him. He's been here for 25, 27 years, something like that. He's been here a long time. 25 years, I think. Don't hold me to that exactly, but I'm pretty sure it's pretty close.
And he's here for murder?
Yes.
What happened? How old was he when...
He was a young man. He was in his 20s, I believe.
And what went wrong in his case? You think he still was a product also of, you know, what you went through?
We come from the same father.
Do you see him, Richard?
I pass him.
What do you say, just hello and keep on walking?
How you doing, Joe? How you? Take care.
That's it?
Told you I have dual short stories. That's being over-friendly with my brother.
Does he try to talk to you?
He says less to me, as a matter of fact. Sometimes he doesn't even answer me, I don't think, thinking about it.
That's too bad.
Depends how you look at it.
Is there anything you wouldn't do, Richard, for a contract murder?
Yes.
What wouldn't you do?
I wouldn't kill the child. And most likely wouldn't kill a woman.
Did you ever let anyone go for whatever reason? Did you ever decide to let someone go?
Yes. Then I thought better of the idea and shot him anyway.
Did you ever murder anyone you liked?
All my friends did. At one point in time, I'm sure I liked them.
But not at the moment of killing them.
I might have even liked them then. Honor among thieves? There's no such thing. You see, because I was put in prison by a man I knew 30 years, and I liked him. Big mistake. I had one friend too many. I'm now serving multi-life sentences because of my one friend. And he's the only friend I didn't kill. Hoffa?
Yeah.
I don't know anything about Hoffa. Jimmy Hoffa.
Oh, the scuttlebutt, let's put it that way.
Scuttlebutt, he's in a Japanese car. Supposedly he was picked up, put in a drum, put in a trunk of a car, put in a crusher with other cars, crushed, and shipped overseas. That's what I heard. Don't know.
I think the last time I asked you that, you thought he was a Toyota.
Could be a Toyota. Some little Japanese car.
Did you think of yourself as an assassin?
Assassin? Sounds so exotic. I was just a murderer.
If I understand you correctly, you're positive you killed more than 50 people. And
definitely.
You think you probably killed more than 100 people.
Definitely.
You're sure of that one?
Definitely.
But not sure it's more than 200?
I wouldn't say definitely to that.
Maybe yes, maybe no.
I would say less than 200 people.
Will you tell me?
It's not less than 200 people.
You killed more than 200 people?
Sure. Yep. I killed, basically, more 100 people when I was a young man. Before I even knew anybody. Too much. One part of my life, I killed people for nothing. Just for somebody to look at me wrong, I would kill them. Stab them, shoot them.
You tended to shoot people up close and personal.
Definitely. I wanted to tell them just before they left. I wanted to say goodbye.
Did you like to look them in the eye?
I wanted them looking straight at me. This was a long way away. The distance we are now, we were closer.
What did you want them to think as they died?
Just see my pretty face. I take it to them. But the last thing they ever saw was me. And if they carry that glimpse to eternity, infinity, or whatever it is, they're gonna be thinking of me all that time. I'd be looking in their eyes. I would see the blankness come over it. I'd watch them die. I just didn't shoot them and walk away. I saw the surprise, the shock, the blank. They're gone. And all I saw was my reflection. But that's it.
Did you have a favorite place you'd like to shoot?
A favorite?
Yeah.
Well, most of the time, if you're up close, you shoot them under the chin. You would shoot them. Shot a guy one time in his Adam's apple. See how long it would take him to die.
How long did it take?
A few minutes. He drowned, actually. He didn't.
Drowned in his blood?
Mm-hmm. I was with somebody else. We had a $50 bet. I lost. I took a guy down one time, just following him around. He was with a few people. Now, as they went to the bar, this person decided he couldn't wait to get inside to urinate. He never did. Everybody else went in. He stayed outside to urinate. He urinated. He went comfortably anyway. He had an empty bladder. But I actually strangled him.
From behind, I assume.
Definitely. I actually did it in a way that's maybe this is original. And maybe not, I don't know. But I put the rope around his neck, twisted it, and threw him over my shoulder and held him there. So actually, I was the tree hanging him.
Yeah.
And he eventually just stopped kicking. And I let it loose at one end. He slid down to the ground. I put him over by the garbage and left.
Had you brought a length of rope with you?
No, actually, these people had around the back at a bar. They must have lived upstairs. There was an apartment upstairs, and they had one of these things where they had rope across this thing, and they had a couple of these lines going across this way. And that's what I took.
Talking about clothesline?
Yeah.
Now, what had this guy done to you?
I didn't like him. He just made me mad for some reason or other. For me to track him and wait for him, I was mad at him for something.
Do you remember what his body did while you were hanging him?
Yeah, I was twitching and kicking.
How long did it take?
I don't really know. Didn't look at my watch, so I really couldn't say. You know, I kept him a while. Even after he stopped, I kept him a while just to make sure.
Did you have another weapon with you?
Yes.
But this was quieter.
It was more personal. I actually felt him die.
Did you like that?
Didn't do anything. But I mean, I did feel him die. I felt him go limp.
And you got your relief?
Yes. Basically, I didn't have any more pressure, no more tension. It was almost like a cure-all. Unbelievable.
What's the worst beating you ever took from your old man?
I don't think there's much difference in any of them. They were all pretty bad. He left his mark on me, pretty much.
And he did most of that before you were, what, 11?
Yes, I was young.
And was that worse when he was drinking?
With Stanley, it didn't really matter whether he was drinking or he wasn't drinking. He was a nasty son of a bitch, and he always will be until the day he died. And even when he died, he was a nasty son of a gun.
Did you go to his funeral?
No, I didn't.
Was there one?
Yes. I didn't like him in life. Why would I want to go see him in death? I was glad he was dead.
How about your mom? How was she?
Over the years, I got to dislike my mother a great deal. But now that I have more time to think about it, she was just a victim of her own life.
As a kid, how did you see her?
Hateful. Disliked her a great deal. She didn't believe in sparing a rod either. I mean, she used to hit me with a broomstick if I did something wrong.
Where would she hit you?
Wherever it hit. He gave me a picture of him and a description of what he does and what he generally does and where he goes, places he goes. And so I went to the area where they said he might be, and I saw somebody who looked like him, similar to him. He had a knack for smoking, and they told me he smoked big cigars, Churchill cigars or something. So I pulled up alongside of him. At the time, I was riding a motorcycle. And I just said, Cuban? Are they Cuban? Looks like a good cigar. And he wasn't a happy camper, because he said, fuck you. When he said, fuck you, he looked my way, and I got a clear shot of his face. It was a picture I had of the man they wanted. And I said, nah, don't fuck me, fuck you. And I just took this weapon out and blew his head off. It just disintegrated his, like you see a pumpkin get hit with a shotgun or something, they just spread out. And that's what happened. And I, light turned green about the time I shot him, and I left. I was driving in Georgia one time, and we were riding down the road, and there was a couple of vans running around, and they were hooping and hollering there. I guess they were having a good old time and maybe drinking and whatnot. They decided, I guess it was interesting to play with a guy from New Jersey, and they started click-clacking with their vans and push me here and push me there, off the road, and they were running in and out, and what their problem was, I really don't know. Never did know. But it came to a point where I got extremely mad about that, but it was silly of me because I was away from home. I had no backing, I had no problem. I only had one weapon, which was in the trunk, which was a .357 with a hair trigger. So I stopped the car and got out, opened the trunk. I had the release and went in the trunk and took the .357 and just stood there. Now, apparently their eyesight mustn't be too good because I don't think I'd walk up on a guy with a .357 standing by his side. But these fellas did. Foolish mistake. They all died. And I didn't even know them.
How many?
There was a few of them. I reloaded.
Killed every last one of them.
Yeah. And that wasn't even one I wanted to do.
Do you think that what they did was a capital offense?
What they did? You mean playing with me? Yeah. Well, they could have killed me. Well, they ran me off the road and I died.
Bad behavior, no argument. Reckless endangerment. Reckless driving, host of bad things. Is it a capital offense they committed against you?
Apparently. I did kill him. So to me, it must have been. Because when I had come to that point, and that point, that is the last point they come to. I don't back off once I go forward. Once I go forward and I take a gun, I do not back off. I didn't know how many they had. I didn't know what they had. They could have had guns. They could have had anything. They wanted to play with me. I didn't want to play. So we didn't play no more. And I would have taken whatever came. You almost made me mad.
I know. What made you mad about that?
I don't know, but you almost did.
Can you figure out what it is?
No.
Try to look at it. Look at what made you mad there.
I don't know. I think it must have been something you said.
Yeah.
Obviously, but I don't know what it was.
Could it be that I was challenging you and it sounded judgmental?
Could be. Yeah, it could be. Because you've got me annoyed with you now.
Yeah.
That's the truth.
How mad are you?
Not bad. Pretty. I feel a little flushed. So that means that I've reached a point in my life that I'm a little annoyed.
What would you like to do?
Doesn't matter. I don't think it's gone to the point that I'm actually gonna do anything stupid. Just curious to myself why it happened. I don't know why it happened. I'm actually almost glad it did happen because you had a chance to see something. But I don't know why it happened.
Did you feel I was criticizing you?
Yes.
Is that what did it?
I think so. I think that's the part that did it.
Who used to criticize you the most?
Of course, my father.
Yeah. Most people, when they see horrible things, if they see somebody badly injured, certainly see something that awful, have a visceral reaction. They feel nauseated. They may want to vomit.
Mm.
It makes them very uncomfortable all over real fast.
Mm.
Did you get anything?
No, it's a good thing I didn't have to vomit because then I would have had real problems on that motorcycle. Not to care is much better.
Because it's a weakness to care.
That's right, it is. Then you have baggage. When you care, you can't just move. You have to worry.
And you got something to lose.
That's right.
Dismembering bodies, did that turn your stomach?
I don't think so. I remember having pizza one day while we were doing something like that.
Pizza in one hand, chainsaw in the other?
No. I didn't like chainsaws. That's another fable that they've come up with, that I use chainsaws. See, chainsaws are messy.
Yep.
All you get is little, all over me I have these little pieces of meat. Now that's a pain in the neck if I use chainsaws. Now, would I want to ruin a good shirt with a chainsaw? That would be downright stupid. And I definitely have the wrong. I don't think I could walk around with bits of meat hanging off me or bits and pieces of somebody's body hanging off me. I would probably smell a little bit bad also at that point.
So what's a better way to dismember a body?
Just a knife. A butcher knife, you know, you cut it around the bone and a little slice here, a little slice there, and wrap it, ship it.
Do you understand that most people can't imagine doing that to a human?
Sure. I can understand that a great deal. I can't understand why I can. The smell sometimes was annoying, but I would put cologne on. I would generally put cologne across here so I could smell the cologne a lot better than I could smell anything else. Canoe or something like that was always nice.
Now you're dating yourself with that.
But it was still nice.
What else would you use for the smell?
Spray, you know, any deodorizers, you know, spray, put it in the air, and try to kill the smell. But the deodorizers actually were worse than the smell because when they mingled, somehow or other, they gave off a more distasteful smell. So what I would take is a bottle of Canoe and just throw it all over the walls and the floor and everything. And I'd have a $25 nice smell in the room. It was an expensive deodorant, but it worked. I used to have a thing where I would take somebody into a cavern or a cave, whatever you want to call it. And I would tie them up or tape them, their hands and their feet together. And then I would leave them there. And I'd leave a camera on. And rats used to eat them. Rats used to kill these people. It was a very painful death for these people because rats would eventually smell them or come near them, and start nibbling away at them. The people would definitely scream and yell and holler and try to get away. And eventually more rats would come, and they would consume these people eventually. You know, but there was a lot of screaming and yelling in between. But when I did that and I watched it on The Devil, was that Super 8, I think it was, I found it distasteful, and it used to make me nervous for some reason. And so that was some type of a feeling which I wasn't too keen on having. But I did it because it gave me a feeling of some kind, and therefore I was trying to find out what it was that was giving me some type of feeling. Whether it was the horror of what was going on, or the screaming that was happening, or just the nastiness of it. But I never figured it out. But I did that quite a few times, too. Maybe too many times.
And watched it?
Yes. I beat a guy at that one time. I had blood in my shoes. His blood in my shoes. It just goes on that way. I had to throw all my clothes away. Here I was driving a big Lincoln Town Car with butt naked. Had a sheet wrapped around me. We're having too much fun, you know that? You realize that? I'm coming across like a nice guy. Nobody's gonna believe this. Nobody. I wouldn't believe this if I was watching this. Because I'm the furthest thing from a nice guy. I am what you call a person's nightmare. Because of the way I project myself, people think they can get by. And then all of a sudden, when they wake up, it's too late. They already hit the stop sign. And that's a dead stop.
But there have been people you've been good to, aren't there?
Not many. There have been people. I don't know what you consider good. Your interpretation of good might be different than mine. I don't know. What do you mean good?
Well, how do you think you were with your kids?
Oh, the kids. Now you're talking completely different. Now you're talking black and white. There was nothing I wouldn't do for my children. Nothing. I'd kill everybody in this room for them. That's just to show you a point. Not that I would or want to, I'm just saying I would. If it meant I had to for them, I would do it without even thinking twice. It might upset me, it might hurt me, but I would do it.
Who else were you good with?
Good with? There aren't many people I was good with. It was only my family. It's good to my family. And even those people I hurt.
How?
Just by being there. I was a nasty son of a gun. I am a nasty son of a gun.
What would happen at home?
You name it. Violence, I think they call it domestic violence. Yes, I've cornered it all. There's nothing I haven't done and nothing she hasn't put up with. I'm not proud of it, it's the way it is. I could say I'm sorry, what good would it do? I couldn't have been too sorry, I did it again. But yet I was sorry. I couldn't control it. It's one of those things, couldn't control it. I found something I couldn't control. Almost a hate, love, hate, love, relationship. So I really liked, loved the girl. But when I got mad, I forgot all that. And wound up hurting the person I loved. So where did I really love her? I still hurt her.
He reveals to Dr. Dietz how far he would go to prove his faith in his wife, even in the midst of a violent quarrel.
I believe I attempted her to do it. I gave her a knife and told her, here, here's a chance you'll never get again, or something like that. And I turned around. Now she had a chance. She didn't do anything. She dropped it on the floor and walked away. And I left the house.
There was a stabbing between your parents, wasn't there?
Yes, there was.
What room was that in?
I don't remember.
What happened?
I don't remember. I don't know. Stanley stabbed... Anna, which, why, I don't recall. I don't remember what it was all about, but I remember it did happen, yeah.
Stabbed her in the back.
Yeah.
And here you are inviting Barbara to do that to you.
Stupid, wasn't it? Yeah, but I did. Yeah, it's true.
Were you testing her?
You're trying to, I don't know, it might have been. I may have, would have been a powerful thing if I was wrong.
Yeah.
I definitely would have got the point.
Told you he had a sense of humor.
I know you did. That's why I threw that in there.
Well, why don't we turn the tables here and you interview me? I'll answer your questions.
Interesting. I could live with that. Just so happens I might have a question for you. What do you think about me? Anything good, bad, or indifferent?
Yeah, some of each. The issues about your behavior, I think there are really a couple things to say. The things that I'm most sure of, based on the information you've told me, are that your principal problem has been a warp in your personality. And we classify personality according to different types. And there are two types of personality features that you have a great deal of. The first of them is called antisocial personality disorder. What it refers to behaviorally is someone who does not have a conscience, does not have remorse, does not feel a sense of guilt about most of the bad things they do, is impulsive and violent. The typical things we see before age 15 in people who earn that label are cruelty toward animals, cruelty toward people. And an awfully interesting part of that condition is that we've got a little bit of knowledge of what causes it and where it comes from. And that's where there's some good news and some bad news. The bad news is that part of where that comes from is hereditary, that there's a genetic basis to being a fearless person. And you've told me about how rarely you have any experience that even begins to resemble nervousness or fear. It takes extreme things to make you have a sense of impending danger. Normal people get fearful about a wide variety of things frequently and would be beside themselves with the kinds of experiences that you had on a weekly basis. You couldn't have done the things you did if you were capable of ordinary fear. But the fact that you're born with a genetic predisposition to fearlessness doesn't mean that it's inevitable for you to become a criminal. Because some people who have that genetic predisposition to fearlessness become pro-social risk takers. They do things like drive race cars, test fly planes, fighter pilots, bomb disposal technicians. Now, those are all jobs where it helps to have a lot of fearlessness. And in fact, some people in law enforcement are brave and have that same capacity to be fearless. And the difference between the people who grow up to be risk-taking good guys with white hats and the people who grow up to be risk-taking bad guys with a long, long rap sheet and a lot of crimes has to do with how their parents raise them. If you raise a kid with love and kindness and affection most of the time, you've got a good shot at their growing up to be decent, caring, loving human beings and treating their own kids well. But if you raise a kid the way Stanley raised you, with no love no affection, constant abuse, beatings for no reason. All you teach is hatred. You make it impossible for that child to grow up and form strong attachments and loving, caring relationships, or to be willing to risk themselves to protect the world. So I think you got to be this kind of antisocial, psychopathic person, both by getting Stanley's genes and having Stanley's parenting and your mother's cold, standoffish way of treating you. In other words, that part of you was both born and made. But your own kids and your own grandchildren will turn out according to how you and Barbara raised them, despite whatever genetic influence there may be. The other thing that I think is true about you is another personality style, where I think it's fair to say that you've got the features of what we call a paranoid personality disorder. The general rule for someone who is paranoid is to trust no one, let no one get too close to you, and to never forgive anyone who does you wrong. If somebody criticizes them, they're quick to respond with anger or to counterattack. If somebody humiliates them, then they must have revenge. About 1 to 2% of the population has the paranoid personality disorder. About 2 to 3% of males and 1% of females have the antisocial personality disorder. And then there's a smaller group that has both. And it was having both that allows you to have this career that you've had, and that allowed you to profit from your capacity for a completely emotionless, fearless, remorseless hit. By being free of any conscience and also free of friends and of people who could bring you down, you were able to have a very long run as a successful contract killer, which is quite unusual. And you wouldn't have been able to do that had you not had both of those personality flaws in your line of work that turned out to be major advantages, kind of preconditions for a successful career.
I appreciate you taking the time and explaining this to me. I am probably the loneliest person in the world because I have nothing I care for. And I can't make any friends to have any kind of a relationship or... So I've lost everything. I've lost everything I ever cared for, everything I ever wanted. It's down the toilet. Since there is no love in my life, I must have something to replace it, so I replace it with hate. Constant hate. Constant reminder to hate.
And what's that do for you?
Keeps my left foot going in front of my right foot. Keeps me moving. Without it, I would probably just plop down someplace and have no reason to continue.
Is that all you've got left is hate?
That's all I've got left. Everything that I ever cared for is gone. Everything I ever liked is gone. Everything that meant anything to me is gone. So hate.
That's all you started with, too.
Then I've come full circle. It's time for me to die.
Law enforcement authorities have arrested one of the most notorious contract killers in state history. A self-employed Bergen County man is behind bars, charged with 5 murders, and prosecutors are investigating his involvement in dozens more.
This is unwarranted, unnecessary. These guys watch too many movies.
He is such a cold-blooded killer, they call him the Iceman. After being convicted of 2 murders, he confessed to 2 others in court today.
I shot George Malvin 5 times. Louis Masgay on July 1st, 1981. I shot him once in the back of the head.
When the judge asked him why he had killed the 2 men, Kuklinski replied,
"It was due to business."
Dominic Polifrone's tapes had nailed Kuklinski. But in court, the Iceman greeted the undercover cop with a smile.
He seemed to be quite cheery about saying hello to you.
Well, I reciprocated. The only thing is, I'm going home, and he's going to a different environment at the present time.
I portrayed myself as a hitman. I told him I worked for the wise guys downtown New York, and my brother was a good fella downtown, and I went by the name of Dominic Michael Provenzano.
You willing to go out on a contract?
If the price is right, I'll talk to anybody.
Yeah?
Sure.
And you mean to tell me your way is nice and clean and nothing fucking shows up?
Well, it may show, my friend, but it's quiet. It's not messy. It's not noisy. It's not, you know.
Yeah, but how the fuck do you put it together, like, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, there's always a way. There's a will, there's a way, my friend.
We used to sit down, we'd talk. Either we'd go to those tables over there and get away from people, and we'd discuss how to murder people.
You know, I just have a few problems I want to dispose of. I have some rats I want to get rid of.
Yeah. The only fucking thing I don't understand, don't you use a fucking piece of iron to get rid of these fucking people? Use this fucking cyanide?
Why be messy? You can do it nice and calm.
It became apparent at later points in the investigation that Mr. Kuklinski fully intended on murdering Dominic Polifrone, in addition to the victims that were being discussed at the time they were having these tape-recorded conversations. So he could pretty much tell Dominic Polifrone anything, because he knew shortly that he had plans for Mr. Polifrone, too.
You put that stuff in a mist, you spray it in somebody's face, and they go to sleep.
No shit. As long as he's dead, that's the bottom line.
Well, that's the thing, isn't it? No matter how it was done, I mean, I know guys that went to sleep and never woke up again. I mean, you know.
He says he had one guy, he went and get a hamburger, they come back and he put the cyanide on his hamburger. And we're sitting down and he's telling me, he says, "You wouldn't believe it." He says, "I'm waiting for this guy to keel over." He says, "Because once you eat cyanide, usually you'd roll over and that's it." He says, "This guy had the constitution of a fucking bull." He says, "You wouldn't believe it." He says he wouldn't die, and we're both laughing about this. And I'm saying in the back of my mind, I said, "Holy God." I said, "Look at this." I said, "What kind of person is this?" I said to myself right there, I said, "You better cover your butt." I said, "Because you just don't know with this guy." And he'd be kidding about it, and I'd be laughing. In the back of my mind, I'm saying, this is the devil. No question about it, this is the devil.
I've never felt sorry for anything I've done other than hurting my family. The only thing I feel sorry for I'm not looking for forgiveness, and I'm not repenting. No, I'm wrong. I'm wrong. I do want my family to forgive me. Oh, boy. I'm gonna make this one. Oh, shit. This would never be me. This would not be me. I feel for my family. you see the Iceman cry. Not very macho. But I've heard people that mean everything to me. But the only people that mean anything to me.